Guten Vormittag, good morning, my name is Roman PAPŠÍK and I am dissertant at the University of Leoben, where I work at the Chair of Structural and Functional Ceramics on prediction of crack initiation in ceramic laminates designed with residual stresses. This work is motivated by attempts to enhance the reliability of ceramics. Let me explain. Ceramics have some outstanding properties. They can withstand higher temperatures compared to some polymers. They are resistant to corrosion and oxidation compared to some metals. Some ceramics have high hardness or great wear resistance and consequently remain dimensionally stable. But there are two major issues preventing ceramics from broader use by the industry. It is the brittleness and low reliability. First, a common failure of ceramics is due to the brittle fracture. Ceramics have low fracture toughness, which is attributed to lack of slip systems, and unlike in metals, there is no plasticity to dissipate energy when a specimen is being overloaded. It is unfortunate consequence that fracture often leads to a catastrophic failure. Secondly, the strength of ceramics is a stochastic variable with high scatter, which disallows us to guarantee higher reliability. Ceramics contain defects and flaws, such as pores or inclusions, which act as a stress concentrator. A crack usually initiates at these flaws and propagates unstably, leading to breaking of a specimen. The strength is therefore dependent on distribution of flaws and the effective volume in which the flaws are activated. The larger the specimen and bigger the porosity, usually the greater amount of critical flaws to be activated. This scatter of strength is commonly described by the variable distribution, whose diagram we see on the right side. To prevent a catastrophic failure, we need to prevent crack propagation or even initiation. One such strategy which helps stopping of propagating cracks is designing of a specimen out of two materials which have mismatching coefficients of thermal expansion. After cooling down from sintering, layers having different coefficient of thermal expansion will contain compressive or tensile in-plane residual stresses. Such layered architectures may arrest or even prevent cracking, but it comes with a downside of so-called edge or tunneling cracks. As I said, as a consequence of suboptimal design, two new cracks might arise. First kind are so-called edge cracks, which we find in layers with compressive in-plane residual stresses. Yes, compressive residual stresses are positive things which we desire, but unfortunately they transform into tensile out-of-plane residual stresses at the free surface of the specimen's side. When a crack initiates at the surface, it channels around the side and extends further into the depth, stopping only after the Griffith's energy criterion is no longer fulfilled or due to the vanishing out-of-plane stresses. Second kind are so-called tunneling cracks, which appear in layers with tensile in-plane residual stress. They are commonly oriented perpendicularly or close to the perpendicular orientation to the layers and extend through the thickness. The initial location cannot be not known a priori, but it is reasonable to assume that more likely a crack initiates deeper in the bulk rather on the free surface, where the residual stress decreases approximately by one third. Hence, we formulate our objective as: design a laminate with residual stresses to prevent crack propagation, but avoid introducing new cracks. Analyze with computational modeling if there are designs fulfilling our requirement. With regard to computational modeling, a few questions arise. Are we even able to model this problem? Which methods are suitable? Which assumptions or simplifications need to be done? What are the drawbacks of chosen method, and that you will learn now. Simulation of crack propagating through the specimen is connected with issue of determining the crack path. The crack path may depend on chosen method and assumptions. A crack could also bifurcate when crossing a B-material interface, or multiple cracks may conjure together. Modeling of these effects is really not trivial. Similarly, with the modeling of crack initiation, which is connected with the issue of not knowing the location and shape of cracks a priori. There are many flaws and defects in the microstructure, and it would not be reasonable to include this into the model. Commonly, these flaws are regarded as cracks, such that they can be analyzed with the linear elastic fracture mechanics. The microstructure is usually omitted and it is regarded as a homogeneous continuum. The classical fracture mechanics assumes a linear elastic material response and it requires that a crack is present. It can tell us if the crack will propagate further by an infinitesimal increment, either by A, fulfilling the Griffith criterion, which states that the energy release rate, or crack driving force, must be greater than a critical value, or equivalently by fulfilling the Irwin criterion for the close vicinity of the crack tip, which states that the stress intensity factor must be greater than the fracture toughness. Nevertheless, we cannot tell if the crack initiates. Hence, let me introduce you to a concept of finite fracture mechanics. Quoting the Israeli mechanical engineer Zvi Hashin, spontaneous crack formation implies that new cracks appear in a very short time and it is not possible or of interest to follow the history of their development. The formation of new cracks can then be regarded as fracture events. Now this framework requires a criterion for initiation. In 2002, French professor Dominique Leguillon introduced a so-called coupled criterion, which states there must be enough available energy to create a crack and the tensile stress must be greater than the tensile strength, not only at a single location, but all along the proposed crack path. The crack then can jump from zero to a finite length, hence the name, without any equilibrium state in between. Both criteria are necessary, but none of them is sufficient. The methodology for evaluating crack initiation is going to be explained with tunneling cracks, but first let's return to the edge cracks. Let us remind that they appear in layers with compressive in-plane stress, which at the free surface transform into the tensile out-of-plane stress. I would like to point you to works from 2015 and 2016 by Dr. ŠEVEČEK and others, who in this framework of finite fracture mechanics analyze the problem using a 2D model of laminate, which combines materials with different coefficients of thermal expansion, and after analyzing different residual stresses corresponding to the horizontal axis of the graph and thickness, which corresponds to the vertical axis, they concluded that for certain combinations of thicknesses and residual stresses in the graph designated by the white region, edge cracks may not initiate. This is because the energy criterion, which is part of the coupled criterion, is not fulfilled. Circles in the graph designate samples which verified their predictions. Now to the tunneling cracks, which are currently analyzed at our chair. Let us remind that they appear in layers with tensile in-plane residual stresses, and we do not know where they exactly initiate, but it would be reasonable to assume they initiate in the depth. There were some works in the past trying to analyze propagation analytically, namely by Ho and others in 1993, or with the finite fracture mechanics, but with rectangular cracks and without residual stresses, namely by Israel Garcia in 2016. Both previous attempts are not giving any predictions for suitable design. Therefore, we create a novel model and followed a methodology which I describe now. Generally speaking, you can use arbitrary method which allows you to model a geometry and calculate the strain energy. That's all you need. We use the finite element method with following algorithm. A model of bimaterial laminate is created and residual stresses per unit of Kelvin are introduced. We then calculate the strain energy of the specimen without crack. And then we introduce an elliptic crack. Yes, its shape is an assumption. And we again calculate the strain energy. This is done for multiple thicknesses of layers as well as with multiple areas and aspect ratios of the elliptic crack. In the post-processing, we calculate the differential, or you can call it tangential, and then also with incremental, or you can call it second energy release rate. The latter one, second energy release rate, is between state when there is no crack and the state where there is finite size crack, which is the determinative factor in the coupled criterion. The thicker the layer, the more crack sizes can be introduced to it. So on the left side, you see only illustrative image, which shows us how for different crack sizes and aspect ratios, we calculated the energy release rate, which I shown for different thicknesses and displayed with different colors on the right diagram. We calculated up to thickness of 600 microns and we get a surface representing the second energy release rate. Since the model is linear, we can rescale these results for arbitrary residual stresses. The remaining task is to find for given residual stresses, which we choose, a thickness for which none of all plausible cracks would fulfill the criterion of initiation. And we eventually find a combination of residual stresses, which is on the horizontal axis, and layer thicknesses, which are on the vertical axis, for which the plausible cracks would fulfill the stress criterion, that is on the right side of the vertical line in the middle, but not for the energy criterion, that is below the parabolic curve. The light yellow area in the graph shows you a region where tensile residual stresses in the layer overcome the strength of zirconia toughened alumina, that is material which we used, but cracks should not initiate nevertheless because the energy criterion is not fulfilled. And you might ask what is the strength, but that is a topic which I would like to keep for discussion or later for communication. Finally, let us try to use these results for designing a good architecture. The sintering temperature is more precisely the stress-free temperature, is more or less set. We can choose the volume ratio between two materials or more materials, which govern the magnitude of residual stresses. Additionally, this volume ratio can be distributed between layers of different thicknesses. Using two graphs which we obtained for edge cracks on the left side and tunneling cracks on the right side, we would calculate residual stresses in our sample, in our layers, and then look if we are outside of the red regions where both criteria, stress and energy criterion, are fulfilled, hence the cracks may initiate. Only sad fact is that these graphs need to be recalculated for combination of new materials if we choose to combine new materials, but that is not a problem, only minor inconvenience. To summarize, what you could take away from this talk, that would be A. It is possible to design components with different materials and introduce compressive residual stresses to prevent crack propagation. But when you are doing that, use the finite fracture mechanics and the coupled criterion for modeling of crack initiation. And then make some prediction of cracking and optimize the architecture of laminate by choosing convenient layer thickness, so that you not only stop the crack propagation, but you also do not introduce new type of cracks. That's it. Naturally, we are grateful for the support of European Research Council, and I personally thank to Raul BERMEJO, Oldřich ŠEVEČEK, Anna Katarina Hofer and Dominik Legion for their help and collaboration. Stay tuned for an upcoming article which will contain details about our model and also verification by the experiments which are prepared right now. I thank you for your attention and welcome your questions. Thank you.